Hey all, my name is Shelby Hartman. I'm DoubleBlind's co-founder and editor-in-chief, and today we're going to talk about tidal wave mushrooms. The tidal wave mushroom is the love child of the two psilocybe cubensis strains known as Penis Envy and B+. It's an unstable hybrid that's known for a variety of odd mutations, including the sporeless blob or brain-shaped enigma mutation that won the 2021 Psilocybin Cup, now known as the Hyphae Cup. It really gained attention because Hyphae Labs found that at least the samples that were submitted to the Hyphae Cup had an unheard of 3.8% tryptamine content. Doma Nunzio, a mycologist and founder of the spore and testing company Magic Myco, is credited with the first hybridization of Penis Envy and B+ in 2017. Magic Myco describes the cross as their first hybrid fusion project, and many iterations later, at least 11 tidal wave varieties are in circulation from Magic Myco, bearing names like Tidal Wave 2, Tidal Wave 3 Beast, and Tidal Wave BXO. Tidal wave mushrooms may owe their name to the wavy, water-like edges on the bottom of mature caps, but as the name implies, these mushrooms can also pack a punch and have a reputation among psychonauts for their potent psychedelic effects. Because of their mixed lineage and unstable genetics, tidal wave mushrooms can be tough to identify. Chief Technical Officer of Hyphae Labs, Ian Bollinger, told us it's possible for tidal wave spores to produce a, quote, canopy with some completely white caps, some gold caps, and then some of the weird enigma-like blobs all in the same bin from the same genetic. That being said, tidal wave mushrooms are often seen with somewhat long stalks of beige to yellow that bruise blue or greenish blue. Their stems are sometimes larger at the base or contorted in shape. Caps can appear more bulbous when young and will mature to a wider shape that may be convex or plain with a brown or golden color, although this can vary. Because of its Penis Envy lineage, tidal wave mushroom caps tend to be smaller than most other Psilocybe cubensis varieties, and some spore sellers describe them as viscous and slightly gelatinous when wet. Caps will also bruise blue, and tidal wave mushrooms drop dark, purplish-brown spores described as sub-ellipsoid in shape. I don't know what that means. Jeff LeBeau of the Canadian-based mycology company Spore Lab says one of the main attributes that helps distinguish the tidal wave variety is that most of them have a slight waviness or undulation at the bottom of the cap. Another identifier, he told us, is a, quote, rippling on the stem and specifically just below the cap. Ian Bollinger told us, quote, with most of our tools for genetic work, all the Psilocybe cubensis show up the same for the most part. But tidal wave is unique. Tidal wave does show up differently genetically. Though tidal wave comes from hybridization between Penis Envy and B+, tidal wave mushrooms tend to take on more of the attributes of Penis Envy and are usually richer in psilocin and poorer in biocystin compared to Psilocybe cubensis mushrooms outside of the Penis Envy lineage. Biocystin is a psilocybin-like compound found in some psilocybe, but currently researchers don't know much about it. I'll just note interestingly here that, generally speaking, I'll just say that oftentimes when we're talking about shrooms, people refer to psilocybin as the primary psychoactive compound that makes you trip. And it is true that psilocybin makes you trip, but also there are more than 200 different kinds of psilocybin-containing mushrooms, and they all contain a variety of compounds and alkaloids that are working together, probably synergistically, much like the, what do you call it, the entourage effect in cannabis. So there's just a lot that we still don't know about how all of these compounds and alkaloids are working together and creating unique experiences based upon, you know, the strain or the species that you're taking. Some magic mushroom species have higher concentrations of tryptamines. For example, Psilocybe semilanciata or Liberty caps usually test higher than Psilocybe cubensis mushrooms. Psilocybe cubensis tend to clock in at around 1% or a little lower on average in tryptamine content. Lebeau and his team have been isolating genetics at Spore's lab for years in an effort to increase potency, and he told us, quote, "The highest test result we've ever received was about 2.4% content." So the Tidal Wave Enigma sample that took the 2021 psilocybin cup with a 3.82% tryptamines attracted a lot of attention, at least in the mycology community. Lebeau says, based on that, quote, "Tidal Wave could be the most potent cubensis mushroom ever recorded in history." But despite this astonishing number, non-mutated varieties of tidal wave mushrooms can measure much lower in tryptamine content, more akin to what you'd expect for an average or above average psilocybe cubensis. Generally, though, with tidal wave mushrooms, you can expect relatively high potency and intense psychedelic effects. When it comes to the effects of eating psilocybe cubensis mushrooms, some psychonauts subscribe to the notion that a cube is a cube, while others report variety-specific differences. Tidal Wave is usually described by spore sellers as uplifting, stimulating, visual, euphoric, and depression relieving. But psilocybin experiences can vary widely from person to person, and every single trip is different. The truth is that there's basically no research comparing the experiential effects of one strain or variety to another, so be careful what you believe. Concentrations of active compounds can vary from mushroom to mushroom, variety to variety, and species to species, but dedicated psychonauts often talk about experiential differences. Lebeau told us that Tidal Wave takes on more of the characteristics of penis envy in regards to the experience, adding that the higher psilocin concentration is likely responsible for these effects. He says most people report that it's stronger than average and will also feel more euphoric and visually stimulating. Again, I just want to put a disclaimer on this because equally as important as the actual shroom strain or variety you're taking is where you're at the time of the psychedelic experience, what you bring into the experience with you. So if you're going through a really hard time in your life or you're hoping to trip to process some trauma, you can't count on the experience making you feel euphoric just because the spore seller said so. When taking any psychedelic, it's possible to experience intense or uncomfortable sensations, and tidal wave mushrooms are no exception. So you can mitigate certain challenges by taking an appropriate dose for your level of experience and ensuring that you're in a safe environment with people that you trust before eating the mushrooms. As mentioned, your set or mental state also greatly influences the direction and tone of your trip. It can be extremely helpful to take care of yourself in the days leading up to a journey, to come into the experience with the most positive or neutral mindset that you can. We have a ton of information on this YouTube channel and on doubleblindmag.com if you're interested in learning more about how to journey on mushrooms. And while we're on the topic of DoubleBlind's work, I hope you don't mind me telling you a little bit about who we are. Don't worry, we'll get back to tidal waves in no time, but before we do, I just wanted to share with you, in case you didn't know, that I'm a journalist by trade, and that before starting DoubleBlind, I was reporting on psychedelics for Vice, Rolling Stone, Quartz, and a number of other magazines and newspapers and digital media sites. And I started DoubleBlind because I was deeply passionate about educating people on how to safely and respectfully embark on a journey with psychedelics for healing and growth if that's something that they wanted. Now we have a YouTube and a Twitter and a TikTok and all these things that media companies are supposed to have in the 21st century, but we began as a print magazine, and that's still our baby, and it comes out twice a year. And we also help hundreds of thousands of people, literally, with free education like these videos and the articles on our website. And we vowed to never have a paywall over what we do because we don't want to lock people out of the information that they need to feel better. So how do we pay the wonderful humans who make all of this possible? It's through classes, like a class we have where we teach people how to grow their own mushrooms. And we've taught thousands of people around the world how to grow shrooms at home. And we have a team of incredible mycologists who support people every step of the way, plus you get to be a part of our community. So whether you've been following us for a while or you're just stumbling upon us now, if it sounds fun, consider joining our community and growing shrooms with us. And you can sign up at doubleblindmag.com/courses/how-to-grow-mushrooms. Or if that's too hard for your brain to process, you just click the link in the description of this video. Now back to tidal wave shrooms. Penis MD, though popular for its potency and euphoric effects, is notoriously difficult to cultivate because of its slow growth, low yield, and vulnerability to contamination. But fortunately, the tidal wave takes after its B-plus parent when it comes to growing, and is considered a good mushroom for cultivators with a low intermediate level of experience. Tidal wave mycelium is usually described as quick to colonize and bear fruit, and like many other Psilocybe cubensis varieties, is also fairly resistant to contamination. Enigmas and other tidal wave mutations, however, will present more technical challenges for the grower. Tidal wave mushrooms grow well in a variety of common substrates, including rye, brown rice flour, wild bird seed, bovine dung, and equine dung. And they can also thrive in an enriched soil environment and respond well to a moderately warm, humid, and subtropical climate. Under the microscope, tidal wave mushroom spores appear as dark purplish-brown specks with a sub-ellipsoid shape and can be purchased online through a variety of retailers in the US and Canada for research purposes. Note though, spores and growing supplies are accessible, but technically, once you start growing the spores into psilocybin mushrooms, at least in the United States, you're still doing something that's federally illegal. There are a number of jurisdictions, about a dozen, that have decriminalized psilocybin mushrooms and spores. Seattle, San Francisco, Berkeley, Oakland, I'm not gonna remember them all right now, but we cover this on the DoubleBlind website. And this basically means that if you're growing mushrooms at home, it's a low law enforcement priority. That being said, as always, it's good to just be aware of the laws before you do anything. For more videos like this one, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel or check us out at doubleblindmag.com. See you next time.